With the switch to a DDR5 memory-based platform, it looks like AMD has found the magic formula. With no less than 10 Zen 4 processors released at the moment, the red team has managed to corner Intel. And even though Intel has remained pretty competitive when it comes to performance, there's more to a processor than that. It's just that all the praise that AMD had attracted lately turned against them when they introduced the Ryzen 9 7950X3D. Why? Because their logic seems to have been this. We're releasing Ryzen 9 7950X3D and 7900X3D first. People will buy them quickly because they sell in limited numbers, and the success of the 5800X3D has convinced everyone that our technology is primetime shit. We're gonna quickly make some cash, and after the hype dies down on those, we'll pull out the 7800X3D, which is by far the most exciting gaming processor on the market. Nobody's going to notice, right? Nobody except everyone. And that's how, from the underdog you fell so quickly in love with, AMD suddenly turned into what it vowed to never become: its rival. I mean, that's a situation the Reds had better distance themselves fast. And perhaps AMD's best chance is this new Ryzen 7 7800X3D, the first true successor to the 5800X3D. But will it succeed in carrying the family tradition forward, or will it bring even more unwanted attention to AMD's rather commercial recent releases? Let's see. Compared to the 7950X3D, the new Ryzen 7 7800X3D is even more interesting regarding specifications. It has 8 cores and 16 threads, and the secret lies exactly in this selection. AMD Ryzen processors use what we know as chiplet design. They do not come in one piece. Instead, the cores are divided into several modules called CCX, short for core complex. Each CCX comes with 4 cores, and for modern configurations with 8 or 16 cores, the CCXs are grouped 2x2 in larger formations called CCDs, core complex dies. So, simple math shows that an AMD Ryzen 9 7950X3D comes with 2 CCDs, which in total house 16 cores. But in the case of the Ryzen 7800X3D and its 8 cores, everything fits on a single CCD. All this information is important because it directly affects performance. And even more so on these X3D processors. The 3D V-cache memory is not separate from the cores, but is included in a CCD. And because the 7800X3D has only one such CCD, it accesses the memory directly. In the case of the 7950X3D, this memory is mounted on one of the 2 CCDs. This means that when a core on the CCD lacking V-cache needs to access the memory, a small delay will occur. So at least, theoretically, the 7800X3D is faster than the 7950X3D in applications that take the edge of a large amount of cache memory. But for today, I didn't want to compare apples with oranges, or in this case, a $450 processor to a $600 one. So over the course of the review, we'll use the Ryzen 7 7700X as a comparison. Let's see what we get for the price of the new CPU, so here's a comparison table. We know of the 8 cores already, and with AMD's SMT technology, we have a total of 16 threads. The base frequency is 4.2 GHz, and in boost it goes up to 5 GHz. We also have 8 MB of L2 cache and another 96 MB of 3D V-cache memory. The Tdp is 120 watts, which means 162 watts real consumption at 100% usage. And the TJ max value is 89 degrees Celsius. In contrast, the already old Ryzen 7 7700X has a higher boost frequency at 5.4 GHz and lower power consumption, but higher temperatures. Yes, you heard that right. The Tdp is 105 watts on the 7700X, but the TJ max value is 95 degrees. Let's have another table where you will see that put side by side, the two CPUs paint a very strange picture. The AMD Ryzen 7 7800X3D, although more expensive than the 7700X, is a weaker benchmark performer. It scored nearly 1800 points in Cinebench R23 single core test and about 18,000 in multi-core. That means the more expensive chip is 12% weaker in single core and about as strong in multi-core. In Geekbench 6, we have pretty much the same differences. In the single core test, the 7800X3D scored 2600 points, 10% lower than the 7700X, and in multi-core we have a total of 14,600. Otherwise, we ran another test in 7-zip that narrowed the gap between the two CPUs, getting a similar result. The 7800X3D scored 116,000 points, while the 7700X scored 119,000 points. The V-Ray benchmark processor test was also decent. So we have the 7800X3D with 14,000 points and the 7700X with 14,600. Over the whole testing session, at least in benchmarks, we learned a few things. The first is that the single-core performance of the newer, more expensive processor is somehow weaker than that offered by the 7700X. Once you switch to multi-core, the two processors are about 2-3% different, a difference I've seen in all tests. But since these 2% don't matter, I'll focus more on the single-core tests. The explanation is quite simple. The 3D V-cache memory doesn't get along so well with voltage fluctuations and doesn't like heat too much either. This means that AMD had to cut a bit of the boost frequency, and the extra 400 MHz that the 7700X has were noticeable. Besides, with a TJ max value of 89 degrees Celsius, I also expected differences in multi-core. Instead, it just proved to me once again what I already knew. At full load, the 7800X3D worked until it reached 89 degrees Celsius and stayed there for the duration of the test that ran the CPU at over 95% load. But it managed to hit its 5 GHz boost frequency for quite a long time, which indicates that this model, compared to the 7950X3D, is not artificially neutered by AMD to ease the addition of 3D V-cache memory. But let's leave aside this benchmarking nonsense and get to the really important stuff. How does the new Ryzen 7 7800X3D fare in gaming? It fares well, and for comparison, I used both a 7700X and an Intel Core i9-13900K, along with an NVIDIA RTX 4090 GPU and 32GB of DDR5 RAM at 6000 megatransfers per second and CL30 latency. The gaming tests were done at Full HD resolution to increase the load on the processor as much as possible. In this way, we can better measure the differences between processors. The tests are done at Full HD low because I'm just trying to highlight the performance differences to give you an idea of what each CPU can do. The first comparison is between the 7800X3D and the 7700X. The two processors are pretty close to each other in terms of specs, and after seeing the scores in benchmarks, logic says the 7700X is more powerful. But the logic doesn't consider the 3D V-cache memory, which tips the scales in favor of the 7800X3D. But it also lost an important battle in Counter-Strike Global Offensive. Here, the superior frequency of the 7700X spoke for itself, and the new 7800X3D was 9-10% weaker. Otherwise, things look like this. In Assassin's Creed Valhalla, the 7800X3D got 234 frames per second, 864 in CSGO, 240 in Cyberpunk 2077, 211 FPS in Far Cry 6, in Rainbow Six Siege 767 FPS, and in Shadow of the Tomb Raider only about 379 frames per second. Those are very good values, but remember, we're at Full HD on low settings. The 7800X3D managed to beat the 7700X, and in the 6 games we tested, it was at least 10% faster. And that's across a small range of titles, as the difference can grow quite large depending on the games you prefer. The rule of thumb is that the 7700X will be the better choice in frequency-sensitive esports titles. For everything else, there's MasterCard. Oh, sorry, I meant the 7800X3D. However, things change when we put AMD's new gaming processor against the Intel Core i9-13900K beast. As with the comparison here, I'll focus on those 6 games, and the Intel CPU fares a little better. How much does this better actually mean? Not much, as it's somewhere between 2-10%. But that's with a higher number of cores, higher boost frequency, higher power consumption, high cost, and the need for a solid cooling system. And here, it seems to me that AMD achieves something that Intel either won't or can't. AMD doesn't offer the most powerful CPU on the market, but it certainly offers the optimal price-performance choice. And from that point of view, the Ryzen 7 7800X3D seems unbeatable to me. And you know what else this CPU does really well? It puts AMD's own much more expensive 7950X3D to shame. I mean, the performance difference between the two is 1% in favor of the 7800X3D. It means that this CPU is roughly on par with the 13900K and the 7950X3D. I know, if we tested it so much, so why didn't we put it up against the 5800X3D also? Because reasons. I don't have that CPU around anymore, and we don't use a DDR4 test rig anymore, because the industry is already migrating to DDR5. But the story for the new generation of AMD chips is just starting. As we see improvements on the DDR5 support side, driver and BIOS optimizations, and other small fixes typical for a new platform, it will get better and better. Of course, strictly for gaming, the 5800X3D still seems to be the best choice. AM4-based motherboards are cheaper than ever, and DDR4 memory has gone for pennies on the dollar. Other than that, it's just that the CPU is a bit harder to get. But if you take that road, you're assuming you don't have the same upgrade possibilities as those who have already switched to AM5. Basically, it's 2023, and you'd be switching to a platform that came out in 2017. So officially, 7800X3D is now the new 5800X3D. I mean, an affordable CPU that does a great job in gaming. And on the platform side, let's take a look at a direct recommendation from AMD. We were recently talking about AMD's entry-level A620 chipset. And for what the manufacturer calls performance gaming, it looks like all you need is a 7800X3D mounted on an inexpensive A620 motherboard, 32GB of RAM at 6000 megatransfers per second CL32, which isn't so pricey either, and a 12GB Radeon RX 6750 XT GPU. And for Full HD and 1440p, I say this recommendation is just fine. And before you go like, oh, why the A620? It's cheap and stupid. If AMD, who makes both the chipset and the CPU, says they go with each other, they do. There would also be the counter argument that you don't have precision boost overdrive support on these motherboards. Still, the nature of 3D V-cache memory isn't overclocking friendly anyway, so you're not missing anything. You also have Expo profile support for memory, so you can use the modules at full capacity. Going back to what I was saying at the beginning about this somewhat late launch that came after the more expensive and less attractive models, my honest opinion is that AMD knew how good the 7800X3D was going to be. And they also knew that if they launched all 3D V-cache chips at once, two of them won't sell. And the explanation is simple. You can buy now a CPU that is as powerful in games as a $600 or more CPU and doesn't need either an expensive motherboard or high-performance cooling. And over time, maybe the 7800X3D will get cheaper, if we will be able to find it in stock. As for the 7700X, until the 7800X3D came out, it seemed like a good all-around processor. Only now it doesn't sound as nice anymore. However, I think a price adjustment for the 7700X would make it a very good middle ground between the cheaper Ryzen 5 models and the 7800X3D that will run games flawlessly. And now I want you guys to tell me in the comments section, what do you think of the new 7800X3D? Done for the day, but I'll be back in the next few days with a big launch that I can't talk about yet, because it would cost me dearly, both literally and metaphorically. But that won't stop you guys from trying to guess in the comments what it may be. Until then, thanks for watching and smash that subscribe button.